And so we have 309 sub-reviewers. Of course, you cannot see the names, but so we have so many sub-reviewers contribute to the precise review in their expertise. Okay, and so we have selected the best paper awards based on the recommendation by program committee members and voting by programming committee members. And so best paper awards is this paper, and two run-ups are recommended to the Journal of Cryptology of this paper. Okay, and we have three invited speakers. And two technical invited speakers, so recommendation by program committee, and one non-technical invited talk by the recommendation of general, general co-chairs. Okay, so in AsiaCrypt 2016, so we introduced firstly a rebuttal phase. So in the rebuttal phase, we accepted 140 submissions for the second review phase. And so we concentrate on more review based on the rebuttal letter received from authors. And so it was very nice. So we are more concentrated on the intensive review in the second review phase. And so moreover, from last year, we introduced parallel session in AsiaCrypt. So due to parallel session, we can accept about 65 papers. So it's more papers than the 2 years before. And so we had one irregular submissions. So the paper contains many copy from textbook and lecture notes and even Wikipedia. Of course, we rejected it. And so we reported it, this plagiarism to ICR ethic committee. Okay. And I'd like to thank local organizer, general chair, Ngo Bao Chao, and Fan Yun Hu. Especially Hu is working, always learning every 4 years. And so we also thank the local organizing committee. So without your help, we cannot organize this very nice conference. Okay, finally, I'd like to thank all authors who submitted paper to AsiaCrypt, and the session chair, and the excellent lamp session organized by Stephen Galbraith. And finally, thank you for attending this AsiaCrypt. So we thank all the participants. Thank you very much.
Okay. As always, after the talk, are there questions for
the
speaker?
Yes, some questions.
Feedback. This is not a which is not a question. Did authors like the rebuttal and the early rejection? No reaction. So maybe you have to ask, should you do rebuttal and rebuttal again next year? It's good. Yes.
Okay. So one author asked us, after the rejection in the first review phase, they can submit somewhere else. So we said, we report it to the author. So you are, rejection, you can submit to other conference. The chair of the other conference also asked us. It is rejected or not.
Any other feedback? Otherwise, I thank you again. And Junghee, of course. Junghee. I have my own here. Okay, now go back to the IACR presentation, which is here, which is the program chair's report. And now I want to talk about the agenda of the membership meeting. This is basically all the IACR operations that are going to come up now. And there's going to be a time for open discussions towards the end as well. So the IACR, you know, is the International Association for Cryptologic Research. We have been around for more than 30 years. Essentially, with the first crypto in Santa Barbara, the IACR was founded. And the IACR is an independent organization, of course, from the ACM and IEEE and the mathematics societies. Somewhere standing in between, like our field stands, somewhere in between all those bigger fields. This is the organizational structure of the IACR. It's a democratic organization. There are elections every year for a board of directors. And then the board of directors, and there is also a membership assembly in this, at the conferences, there is always also a membership assembly, which has the power to do certain things according to the bylaws. But the regular way we operate is through the elections of a board of directors. But we are here also to discuss in this membership assembly your input and your suggestions. The red color here signifies things that are new. So we didn't start new conferences, but we renamed the conferences from, we renamed the conference types. You know, there are AsiaCrypt, Crypto, EuroCrypt that are called now general conferences. And there are Chess, FSC, and PKC that used to be called workshops. They are now called area conferences because they're focusing a particular area in cryptology. And these are all the other subjects we cover, like from schools to the web server, the ePrint Archive, Journal of Cryptology. Yeah, you are all members of the IACR in 2017 because you registered to AsiaCrypt this year. In general, anyone who registers and attends an IACR conference is a member for the next calendar year. If you do not have the opportunity to attend an IACR conference in a particular calendar year, you can still become a member online until the summer, September or something, yeah? Because at some time we have to make a cutoff for the election basis, the electorate during the each year's election towards the end of the year. The board of directors consists of four officers, nine elected directors, appointed directors. These are general chairs of the general conferences, such as AsiaCrypt, and the chairs of the steering committees for representing the area conferences, yeah? Or a representative of those steering committees to keep the link. Because with so many conferences, we have to have a sort of a hierarchical organization to do the workload. The composition of the board is found on the website. I think there are several board members here, at least. Anyone? Professor Zhu Jialai is certainly a member as the representative of the AsiaCrypt steering committee. Okay. Then we go on here without show of hands. But I'd like to mention a couple of things that have happened at the last board meeting that was at Crypto and also in between. So the board discussed about current current conferences, how they're organized, mainly consolidating the parallel sessions that have been in operation for 2 years now. And I think we are satisfied with this. We have voted last year to keep it like this, or earlier this year, actually. This makes it mandatory that we have some more consistency in video recordings. This is not something that we strictly mandate, but we are generally very much encouraging to have video recordings of the conferences. So we have a first at this conference, which is live streaming. This is thanks to sponsorship that the local organizers could obtain to have sponsored live streaming, which always takes work. And I'd like to thank the organizers for this opportunity. So this is a first, not for this conference. Yeah, there is also at the meeting at Crypto a few few appointments made. So like Mitsuru Matsui will be the ISU Distinguished Lecturer in 2018 at the, oh, I forgot at which conference, but the ISU Distinguished Lecturer is a special invited lecture that's invited by the board and that takes place once a year, rotating between Asia Crypto and Eurocrypt. Yeah, and the further business of the board consists in approving plans for future conferences, and you see the details of this later after this. So this year we had an election also. The election finished a couple of weeks ago only. I thank everybody who voted in the election. There were still only about a third of the whole membership who actually went to vote, even though we are trying, we are using electronic voting technology, the Helios voting system. So we should exploit this. And the elected members of the board are listed here. They will be serving for 3-year terms from 2017 until the end of 2019. If you'd like to run for the board, then you have to talk to a member of the board in the summer because the election takes place every year in the fall. You can also propose to organize an AsiaCrypt or a Eurocrypt and then get in the board as one of the general chairs. Yeah, we are a relatively lean organization in the sense that we spend only 2% of our annual revenue on administrative matters. We do have about 2 million in reserves at this time, which is a very healthy financial situation. This means we can sponsor substantial amounts for students, mainly at conferences, and we do organize this. For example, by giving registration waivers to all student speakers at all the ISER conferences. And we also started schools since we had the Cryptography Research Fund established 2 or 3 years ago. About the membership and statistics, there are currently 1,550 members as of the summer or the cutoff in August, September. From last year, we are slightly up in terms of membership. That usually depends on how popular the locations are where IACR conferences take place. Our biggest conferences are still drawing a couple of hundred people every year. And you see it's quite diverse because it's 1,500 people overall. This is the list by country. The far biggest here is the United States, followed by France and Germany, Japan, and then it's many, many smaller ones. And I'm pretty sure next year Vietnam will be visible here somewhere. And this is good. This is our mission. The ISER publishes the Journal of Cryptology, which is a different kind of publication from the conference publications, which is more of archival nature, which is also more prestigious in the sense that it's a journal publication compared to a conference publication. The current editor-in-chief is Ivan Damgaard, and you, as a member, you can get online access to the journal through the ISER website, where you sign in with your ISER password, and then you get access from there to the Springer Library, where the articles of the journal are published. It used to be that the Journal of Cryptology was mailed to all members, but we stopped killing trees for this, unless you ask and pay for this extra, because you can register for this when you sign up for the ISER membership fee in a particular calendar year. Then you can still get the journal delivered on paper to you when you do this. There's going to be a transition in the Journal of Cryptology in the sense that Ivan Damgaard is retiring from the position of editor-in-chief, and the board has appointed Kenny Patterson to take over this position. So he is currently undergoing a transition phase, and officially Kenny's term starts on January 2017. There is another new journal or journal conference hybrid that we are establishing. the ISCR transactions on symmetric cryptology, TOSC, starts operating as we speak during the whole year as a transaction that operates like a conference journal hybrid together with FSE. So the FSE conference is no longer going to have a proceedings that shows up only at the conference. It is going to receive submissions throughout the year. Every three months, there is a submission deadline, and the program committee has to work throughout the whole year. They will review the papers in those 3 months terms, and the mechanics are that one can get a rejection once and a resubmission on this continuous 3 month cycle. That means also that all the papers that are published in the transactions on symmetric cryptology within 1 year, more or less, are going to be presented at the next FSE conference. So this is integrated with the FSE conference now. The publication of this is being established through an agreement with the University of Bochum, who sponsors this in the sense that they operate a server and a publication system, and all the articles are going to be open access in gold open access. This means that everybody can just download the articles online. There will not be paper publication of these transactions. Yeah, so the operation I started to mention this year, Maria Naya Plasencia and Bart Prunell are the editors in chief. There are those four submission deadlines. Another deadline, I think, was just 2 or 3 weeks ago. And as I said, you can get a decision. There will be a decision after about 2 months. There can be an accept, a conditional accept, or a major revision, and then you have to resubmit within the defined time frame again. And the rule for presenting at the FSE conference is that if your paper is accepted by January of a calendar year, it must be presented at the corresponding FSC conference. Are there questions about this, for example, since this is a new development? Okay. Conference proceedings, we continue to publish them except with the exception of FSC in Springer. You can see and read the conference proceedings online from your IACR, with your IACR account. You can get access to all papers on the Springer homepage. And all the papers that are older than 4 years that are published on the Springer library are accessible there in gold open access. This means that you don't have to sign in to access those papers. We started to sponsor cryptology schools. This is like the school that happened last week in Vietnam here. This was an IACR-sponsored school. That means the IACR sponsors the budget of such an event by an amount that is decided by a schools committee chaired by Michel Abdallah. And the next round of proposals are due end of the year. Not sure if I see Michel anywhere, but if you see, I've seen him before today. But if you would like to organize such a school, talk to Michel or anybody else in the schools committee about the mechanics of doing this. What is a typical IACR school if you have not attended one in the past? Fellows is also a program that the association runs in recognition of members who have served as outstanding examples in crypto research, who have advanced the science and technology and practice by important results and contributions, or who have developed and promoted the free exchange of ideas and kept good relations to other societies and furthered the standing of cryptology as a research field in comparison to the rest of the world. This year, we have nominated four fellows, Etta Dawson, Shai Halevi, Victor Schupp, and Nigel Smarts. There's a fellows committee that you can see also on the website that is receiving nominations by the end of the year again. So a lot of things will happen on December 30 and 31st, if it happens like the submissions to AsiaCrypt. So but there is nothing that prevents anyone from starting earlier with this. Yeah. The fellows committee will then announce or select the fellows for announcement in early next year, so that this can be awarded at one of the 2017 conferences. Online services, we have the iacr.org, and we also have ia.cr, but we have not been in Costa Rica yet for a conference. This is Costa Rica. That will, but we have a DNS presence there. We get a bill every year. So there are Mike Rosolek and Yu is here, certainly, yeah. He's our webmasters and communication secretaries operating the website with all this information that you can post also by sending something for them to submit, but mainly the news feeds that you can tune into there are about the announcements for the IACR, the e-print papers, the job openings, and the events, the calendar of events that are very well used services. If you don't like to, you can subscribe to this by good old-fashioned email, in case you want to, by considering configuring your subscriptions on the IACR web server. But if you'd like to tune into other feeds, then there are various other feeds that report this information around. The publications portal is the part of the server where you can access the online library of Springer. This has now become so, there are so many conference proceedings that we had to introduce these tabs here. You can go to different conferences like this, and then you see the conference proceedings down the year. But compared to carrying around this much of books, this seems, at least for me, the better option to travel with just a password to get to the papers here. Yeah, so there's more online services, as I said, the Cryptology ePrint Archive, I mentioned all of these. There's also a museum of historic papers, papers that have not really been published, but were influential. And there is a bibliography, database, and so on. The Cryptography Research Fund for Students is made from a donation of cryptography research as a division of Rambus in 2014 or 15, I forgot. With this, we have been able to perpetually, at least as long as we can foresee the future, sponsor all the students' participation in IACR conference. That means when you are a student, sorry, a student for the student speakers, yeah? When you are a student and present your own paper at a conference, the IACR absorbs the registration fee from this fund. And we also started the schools program at this time. And if you want the IACR to do further things, please come talk to us, to the members of the board of directors. There is the Cryptology ePrint Archive. This is mainly a new development here in the sense that Tancred Lepoint has become editor, taking over from Nigel Smart, and Sasha Boldireva is the other editor who has already been there for more than 1 year. There are now about 1,200 or even more preprints each year, which is a substantial number. And there is some minimal refereeing going on in the sense of checking. This is a considerable amount of work. But of course, this is a self-driven, bottom-up thing in the sense that authors put their things there. And so every once in a while, the editors also have to complain to authors about certain things. And here's a complaint list of things that people can do wrong. Yeah. So if you submit a paper, make sure it's, for example, the abstract is self-contained, because that actually holds for all papers, for those who don't know how to. Yeah. But that means when you submit a paper, then make sure that you're not using a numerical reference in your abstract, because when somebody gets this through the Twitter feed, this will not be a link that they can click on. And what we also introduced recently is that it now displays math, but only what, so you can include your LaTeX math in the abstract, but you should only include what our MathJax library actually interprets. Any other math would be an error because you see the source code there. Yeah, we also take in all the final versions as they are submitted to the IACR of the conference papers and ensure that this version is available on the Cryptology ePrint archive. And that means that when you post a paper, a final version to the submission system of an accepted paper, then you should declare where in the ePrint archive you have already deposited this paper. If you don't do that, then what you send to the program chairs gets automatically uploaded there. This is most usually not what you want to do because it may introduce some complications. So please be aware of this and realize that you should submit your papers at the latest at the time when you know it's accepted to a conference. Of course, the spirit of the ePrint archives is that you submit your work as soon as it's ready to be released, yeah, whether there is a conference or not. Video recordings, I mentioned already that we are grateful to have streaming here. This means that together with the archiving that we will do later, and we have done in the past, we operate a channel on YouTube that's thanks to Kevin McCurley, who's operating and uploading videos from the conferences. We would like to maintain this for the future conferences as well, so that the parallel sessions, you can see what happened in the other track. The IACR copyright form, when you upload the final paper, asks you for giving permission to record. And a change that occurred earlier this year is that we decided to move towards a situation where you can no longer opt out so easily, in the sense that you should now decide if you do not want your talk to be recorded, then you should get an exception that has to be handled by the organizers and by the IACR person responsible for this, compared to before where you could just click yes or no. So we would like that all papers and all presentations are recorded and the future submitters are aware of this, because this is written in the call for papers as well. If you are somebody who wants to edit videos and work with videos, we are in the need for volunteers to help with the website all the time. So if somebody wants to join the board or the team helping the IACR, please contact me. Now's the time for open discussion. Any questions on what I've said before? I've been told that we shouldn't take until 5:30, but it's only 6 o'clock. So we have at least 15 minutes or more for discussion before they will have to rearrange the room here to make space for the banquet tables. Suggestions, feedback, yes? So does the board feel the acceptance rate and the publication throughput has stabilized? I don't think the board has officially discussed that and reached a conclusion on it. I do personally think that the experience of a conference is much more relaxed with the parallel sessions. Because we had some conferences that had also 60 papers in the same time frame. So with the parallel sessions, I think it's much more relaxed because it gives us time for more invited talks and activities like this. That's a feeling that the board confirmed when we discussed it earlier. About the acceptance rate, we didn't specifically discuss that because the board likes to have the position that it is not interfering with the scientific discussions of the program chairs. So maybe you should ask in the room if people think the acceptance rate, what is the acceptance rate? Yeah?
Already judging a lot. People are more accepting more
Okay. I don't know about you're saying that the statistics is still varying, yeah? I'm not sure how much it's varying. I mean, when I looked at the statistics of the submissions that Tsuyoshi presented before, it was clear that the acceptance rate would look much better now since we have the parallel sessions and 60 or 70 papers compared to how it looked in when there were 300 submissions for single track, yeah? That is a good observation. Yeah. It hasn't stabilized yet. We will see more what happens, yeah. The board does not recommend a particular acceptance rate. This is always up to the program chairs and their committee to decide, yeah. I would think that the acceptance rate here, did you show the number? It was like 25 to 30, between 25 and 30%, maybe. 25? Yeah. It's hard to come up with a number like this, right? Because did you want to make a suggestion of either way that it should go up or down? Okay, so I infer that it was lower 2 years ago. It was probably around 20, between 15 and 20, yeah. Okay, thanks for that feedback or input. Further remarks and suggestions about the operation. The organizers of next year and then the year after next year are certainly here, and they will be happy to hear from you what you liked this year and what you will want to see next year. Yes? Oh, the impact factor of the Journal of Cryptology. This is something I have to admit I do not see through, because the journal impact factor of journal is mainly done by this one company, apart from what Google Scholar and now other scholars tell you. There is something called Semantic Scholar that also came up. What has happened, but also this is a while ago, that the conference papers were no longer counted as citations for journal papers. That may have impacted the Journal of Cryptology's impact factor. Only what was cited by another journal. For me, this is more of an issue of the counting mechanism and the cultural imbalance between conferences in our field that mean much and conferences in other fields where a publication does not mean as much. And I think there is further refinement needed, certainly on behalf of those counting agencies and counting services. Now you can do like Google Scholar, that just seems to count anything. At least 10 years ago, it counted my lecture notes of a course I was teaching that cited some papers as citations. I think it has become more refined like this, but this is something we cannot really influence directly. We have to do what other fields are doing as well. So clearly the move to establish the transactions on symmetric cryptology, the conference, the transactions that is now taking the papers of FSC, was influenced by the perception that conference publication in certain fields and certain areas and certain regions also, that conference publications are not well respected. And so that has triggered the move of the FSC steering committee to adopt this model. The ISCR is open to doing this, but it has to come from a particular movement, yeah? we discussed once, and this is again 4 years or 5 years ago, we discussed once whether we could turn everything into a conference journal hybrid, but we have abandoned this idea because it would have been disruptive for a too large fraction of the audience and membership. So we did not do this, yeah. I think the most promising way to get more journal-like publications is when the other area conferences that have a certain autonomy, more than a crypto or Eurocrypt would have autonomy, because they are more, together with AsiaCrypt, Eurocrypt, they're more, the three of them are treated in a similar way, usually, yeah, by the policies that we have established over the years, yeah. There are other suggestions, feedback. Okay, then we are proceeding to your future travel schedule at the end here, which includes the new schools in cryptology that we approved and to fund for next year. It's going to be a school in Graz in the spring on the security and correctness in the Internet of Things. There's going to be a school in Latin America, in Cuba actually, taking place in September. There is Eurocrypt coming up in Paris in April, May. There is crypto coming up in August in Santa Barbara. There is AsiaCrypt next year in Hong Kong. There is Eurocrypt in 2018 in Tel Aviv, organized by Or Dunkelmann as general chair, and Jesper Nielsen, Vincent Ryman are going to be program chairs. There is also Crypto in 2018 in Santa Barbara. Tal Rabin will be program chair, general chair. She's actually been program chair. And Olaf Schacham and somebody yet to be named will be program co-chairs. AsiaCrypt 18 has been decided already. It's going to be in Brisbane. And that's where the distinguished lecture of Mitsuru Matsui will take place, now that I remember. Eurocrypt has also been decided for 2019 will be taking place in Darmstadt, in Germany. And next year's area conferences are going to be FSC in Tokyo, PKC in Amsterdam, CHESS in Taipei, and TCC in Baltimore, Maryland. And that's it. I thank you for your attention, and we'll be back here at 7:30, for the banquet. Thank you.